श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम 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 श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम हरि ओम टू एवरीबॉडी फॉर द पास्ट फ्यू डे वी हैव बीन प्रॉम्प्टेड फ्रॉम विद इन टू डेल मोर एंड मोर ऑन द मैन ऑफ स्टडी विजडम ऑन आवर बिहाफ In the midst of various challenges, Arjuna asked Lord Krishna, how do I have a concept about a man of steady wisdom? Because without a steady wisdom, in whatever field God places in, we will not be successful. If we are always oscillating, if we are infirm, we will never be able to qualify ourselves for a higher realm. So he starts addressing, as you have heard many a time, Mahatmaji in Vardhashram. Everyday prayer is there. Everyday so many routines are there to touch and kindle the spiritual aspect in us. But this has made a permanent thing to read these 18 slokas. second chapter has got about 72 slogans, and from 54 to 72, it is fully on this description of the man of steady wisdom. Every sloga is rich in its content, and when we keep on dwelling on it, we find it is directly related to our own life. Whether we are leading a family life, professional life, social life, personal life, labeled spiritual life, whatever it may be, this is a must. So we will first go through the 3-4 slogans which have gone through and then take up a question. Vatahadi yatha kaman sarvan partha manogatan आत्मन्येव आत्मना तुष्टः स्थितप्रज्ञस्य तद्वदोच्यते। दुःखेषु अनिद्विग्रमणाः सुखेषु विकटस्पृहः वीतरागभयक्रोधः स्थितधीर्मुनिरुच्यते। य सर्वत्रानभिनन्येह तत्तत्प्राप्यशुभाशुभम् नाभिनंदति न द्वेष्टि तस्य प्रज्ञाभिष्ठितः। यदा संहरते चायं कूर्मांगानीव सर्वशः इन्द्रियाणीन्द्रियास्तेभ्यः तस्य प्रज्ञाभिष्ठितः। विषया विनिवर्तन्ते निराहारस्य देहिनः रसवर्ज्यं रसोप्यस्य परं दृष्ट्वा निवर्तते। फाइव श्लोक It is easy to chant, learn by heart the sloka and then to reproduce. That is not the purpose. At least some point from each sloka. So the first sloka, what strikes towards is the one should feel content. Atmanyev atmana tushtaka.
That's right.
Eh? I am a
good traveler.
Because the procession normally takes place in our mind. So here I am full. I don't need anything. Every now and then we have to ask this question to ourselves. Am I becoming full? If not, what are the reasons? Mine may give you a list. But this constantly hammering on contentment, wholeness, completeness, that is slowly make us to move towards that. Then, the next sloka is a in dukkha. When I am passing through the severest crisis, I don't get depressed. And when I am blessed with all success in my life, I don't get elated. Dukkeshu and vigramana sukeshu vikarasthana vita raga bhayakro. Free from raga bhaya and krodha. Raga means attachment. Anything we habitually handle, anything, we get attached to it. We should be very careful. A small, tiny little thing can become an object of attachment. You all remember Vinobaji telling about that puppy, no? A person who has been able to get rid of all the attachments. But when he had only one spare puppy, loins all. When that was found missing, he became upset. So he says, beautifully he says, whether it is 5/10 or 1/2, it is same. So it is not a question of any, suppose our mind will say, I am free from this, that, this. But whatever we have, suppose we have a concentrated, suppose it is crystallized selfishness. Suppose a crystallized possessiveness is there. So anything that we handle, for over a period, we have to be very careful that we don't get attached to it. It can be a person. It can be a person, it can be an object, it can be a situation. The same pen when you use, the moment you display it, you know you are upset. Simple. What are you searching? I left my pen. It's a constant use, you know. By constantly, again, if we subtly analyze what is happening, the me and mine is slowly stretched onto that particular object. I don't want to part with it. And it upsets me. I am attached to my name. I am attached to my form. I am attached to my power, my position, my status. Think about it. And when somebody touches, I am upset. Attachment. And we have been told attachment paves the way for anger. If I am free from attachment, the chances for getting angry will be lesser. That could be other reason. But normally, attachment paves the way for anger. Attachment paves the way for fear. I may lose it, no? That is why first is that raga bhaya krodha. Vita raga bhaya krodha. So that it stems from even the bhaya and the anger, krodha. Really speaking, it stems from attachment. If somebody does something, you know, we become indifferent. But if my own son, my own father, my own brother, my own son, does something, yes, how can they say? How can he use that word? Because I am attached to him. So these slogans make us to think so that we can redefine our relationship with the men and matters. Men, objects and matters. Think about it. For Vida Raga Bhaya. And then the next chance again he mentions about this attachment. Anati Sneha means attached. Asakti. Infatuation. Craving. I will be free from craving. Then, whether it comes as Shubha or Ashubha, same thing, Ukeshu and the way. Again, amplified. Yesterday you remember, Chinmayananda Swamiji taking it. It is not that a new theme are given, but the same theme is brought out again and again in a beautiful way. Why? Why did he do that? An inspired artist trying to express his mental idea on the canvas in his language of color would often not stand back from the easel and would again with growing tenderness and love approach the child of his art to place a few more strokes with his brush. Here Krishna, inspired by his own theme, is again and again choosing right words to add more light and shade to the picture of a perfect one which he was painting upon the heart slab of the Rinanar Arjuna. He has written again some beautification.
Touching.
Suppose when the work is on, you may go and see, the artist will immediately say, final touch-up is not over. He comes back, looks at it. What has been conceived of in his mind, whether it has fully been depicted. If not, again one more touch. Goes back, looks at it, one more touch. So here he says, Vitaraga Vayakrota, Dukesh Anidvigyamana, Sukesh Vigalapraya. He is not satisfied. The same word again he says. Tattat Prapti Shubhashita. Whether it is auspicious or inauspicious, whether it is positive or negative, he will be able to maintain the same. If we again closely analyze how is it possible, it is because it is devoid of attachment. Devoid of attachment means we are trying to accept everything as it is. The Shubha and Ashubha definition of label we paste because we have already expected, you know, we have labeled this is Shubha, this is Ashubha. Ordinary normal people, you know, it is not a subnormal or an abnormal way of thinking, it is a normal way of thinking. But should we be upset? You think, okay, if it is not there, expectation will be there. But immediately we accept, oh, that is all right. So, yes, sir. Yes, sarvatra na avisneha. Anavisneha means without attachment, without any affection, without any attack, without any infatuation or craving. Anavisneha. Then, he neither rejoices nor hates, whether it is Shubha or Ashubha. Then, from there he moves. We are in the midst of various challenges, absolutely right. At any moment we may slip. Sense objects are so powerful. God made them so powerful, so attractive. So I must have the reed in my hand. Those who have got the reeds in their hand, they are powerful. So what should they do? Like a tortoise, they must be able to withdraw themselves. Whenever the tortoise senses a danger, it immediately withdraws to its shell, so nothing can happen to it. Impervious. It's well insulated, well protected. It is not going out, it is withdrawing. So here we can interpret it as, we become indifferent, positively indifferent, positively we become blind, positively we become deaf. Papa used to quote one parable from Buddha, when he was going, somebody started abusing him, so he heard everything patiently. After the other man stopped, he said, suppose you give me something, mango, and if I don't accept, what happens? He said, it will be impact me only. Already I have not accepted what you have said. Easy way to convince. So whenever somebody says something, we get offended. No? Here, we become deaf. We become blind. We are opening our eyes, but we are blind. That means we have shut the door there. We have withdrawn ourselves. We try to bring up in our mind such as the incident where we have slipped down. So this will become very clear. Or wherever he blessed us to stand for. यदा संहरते चायं कूर्मांगानीव सर्वशः इंद्रियाण इंद्रियासेभ्यः तस्य प्रज्ञा पृष्ठः. And from there we move to विषया विनिवर्तन्ते निराहारस्य देहिनः रसवर्जं रसोप्यस्य परं दृष्ट्वा निवर्तते. There we So the objects of the senses turn away from the abstinent person. That means it doesn't exercise any influence on him. The sweetest dish is before us, but we become indifferent. Same thing. We don't give in, we don't become. And here he says, though we may be able to do that, still the rasam may be there in us. The moment we see that, the rasam may be there in a subtle way. It is nice, no doubt, but I won't take it. But he says, that also you will be get over Parangrishwa if you turn towards God. So these are the things which he made us to share. Now, the next one, he wants us, not satisfied with this, the same thing. He says, यततो ह्यपि कौन्तेय पुरुषस्य विवश्चितः इन्द्रियाणि प्रमादीनि हरन्ति प्रसवं मनः. The turbulent senses, O Sanmakundi, do violently carry away the mind of a wise man, though he is striving to control them. So, warning to all of us. I am doing Ramnam, I am doing Bhajan, I have mastered this, I have mastered that, all the mind will say, but the moment something comes up, these are all truths which every human being, boy or girl, should know if character development is the goal of education. What is the constitution of the human system? What are their characteristics? We should know them. Then we can fare better. Ignorance is no fun. In this whole physical system, the sensory system of the human being is very powerful. Every action comes because of its impulse. So let us know the nature of the sensory system. Yatato hyavi kaunteya. Even though one is struggling to discipline the sensory system, purushasya vipashchitaha, even of a very intelligent person, even such a person finds that the sense organs are dragging him or her. Indriyani pramadini haranti prasavam manaha. The powerful sense organs drag away the mind of even a wise man. That is the nature of the sensory energy. In all our books on the science of spirituality, you will find this subject being expounded. This emphasis on self-restraint has no meaning if the human being's personality ends with the body, sense organs and the mind. If they are the only one, then we don't have to hear this. This is the position of our materialistic philosophy, now current in modern Western culture. But this becomes relevant when the depth study of the human being, as done by Vedanta, reveals a luminous and free reality of the Atman in every human being. Because it is there, it is possible. Otherwise, how is it possible? If I am to stop with the body, senses, mind, then it is finished. I will not be able to. But there is a higher realm in me. Because of that only I know that I am slipping. Otherwise, how will I know? In the Manusmriti, there is this beautiful observation. Balavan Indriya Gramo The entire sensory system is very powerful. Vidwan samki darshati. They carry away even a vidwan or a learned person. That is the warning given. Vedanta proclaimed that humanity, the inner journey, takes one to something real and profound. Therefore, we need this control and discipline of sensory energy. In any character formation, a measure of discipline of sensory energy is essential. Otherwise, there is no character formation at all. This attraction of the senses for the sense objects implanted in us, even from the animal stage onward, is the world of Maya in which we all live. We have to reckon with this Maya. Mahamaya, the Supreme Maya, which is described by the Adi Shankaracharya in the Vivek Chudamani, Anirvachaniya Rupa. It can't be defined. As a great wonder and indeterminable. It is the echo of this, what you get in modern quantum physics as something. That Maya is the same as the primordial divine mother Adya Shakti, who exercises, as explained by Sri Ramakrishna, two types of Maya Shakti. One Avidya Shakti, dragging down power, another is Vidya Shakti, power which lifts us up. We sometimes hear of a very highly developed people committing big blunders. Because at that moment, they came under the power of the avidya shakti of Maya. Very often you find this happening in society. So the language is beware. Awakening is necessary. Alertness of mind is necessary. So in me there are two types. Though I am a product of Maya, there is a rare hope for me for my redemption, survival, for my emancipation. Because there is, even though I am in Maya, whatever we are now doing, it is the Vidya Shakti that prompts us to hear all these words. Vidya Shakti, I must keep on nurturing, so that it will want me whenever I go, I am likely to go off the track. Sense organs are very powerful, sense objects are very powerful. At any time they can. So this Vidya Shakti. So we are dealing with so many forces within us. Those forces can consume us. Let us control them, discipline them. Then continue our journey to the highest level of perfection. You keep the mind in a good situation. The senses will carry it to a bad situation. Indriyas have that power. The senses will carry it to a bad situation. So reckon with it. The sloka coming later, 64 and 67, are going to tell us what we should do then. Shall we remain helpless? No. You can have all your senses working among the sense objects. You will no need to fear, provided you are a master. Provided you develop the discipline of the psychic energy within you. If you don't do so, your life will suffer shipwreck in the world. Two great verses are coming immediately after. We are not asked to leave aside our sensory system or the sense objects, but learn how to handle them. Let it not be that you are trying to catch a sensory object, but the sensory object caught you by the neck. If you don't do so, your life will suffer shipwreck in the world. Two great verses are coming immediately after. We are not asked to leave aside our sensory system or the sense objects, but learn how to handle them. Let it not be that you were trying to catch the sensory objects, but the sensory object caught you by the neck. That should not be. You should be the master. There is a saying in Hindi, Kambal Chota Nahi. Somebody saw in a flood water a blanket like thing floating. He thought it was a good blanket. He started towards it to obtain it. The people on the bank were waiting. He is not coming back. They said, leave it. No, it does not leave me. Come away. I cannot come. Because it was a bear. And it had caught hold of him. So, Kambal Chotani. That Kambal does not leave me. That is the story. That is all what Vedanta teaches humanity. To achieve as a goal of human evolution, spiritual freedom. Vivekananda says again and again, work like a master, not like a slave. If horses draw your carriages to wherever the horses want it to go, you become a helpless victim. You are the rider, but you are not free to do so. You are not free, don't be so. Therefore, the next sloka says, to hear the warning, no matter, I must have been in ashram, I must have been with a saint, a number of years I would have served him, I must have been undergoing lot of devil tapas, I must have mastered all Brahma Vidya, everything is there. Next moment I may fall a victim. I should be a devil. And God will test us whether we are impervious, whether we are in a position to stand firm, unaffected, untouched, unattracted by it. Even place ourselves in the circumstances. That is how certain norms are to be maintained. We have shared this, you know, one day when we were going for Arati with Pooja Swamiji, a lot of visitors were there, Westerners were there. So, one Western devotee called me and whispered, when God is same in everybody, why when we go to this places of worship, you know, here in ashram, ladies are sitting on one side, gents are on the other side. God is equal. God is equally in everybody. And why? The Swamiji immediately probably must have heard. He looked at Padishyasi, very humbly. So Swamiji looked at them. In God's eyes we are equal. In our eyes we are separate. You can never forget that. So there is a norm. Why this norm, you know? This norm has to be maintained. Even if we are away from that perception, it is better always to maintain. Eatable, whether it is eatable, seeable, hearable, you know, whatever it may be. Not only limited to one particular object. Anything. There should be some norms. Not for the sake of the norm, but for the sake of advancing towards. I want to become a Siddhaprajna. This should be hammered. I must become a Siddhaprajna. Fixed resolve. I must somehow make it. I should not slip. So I should be alert. I should be vigilant. All Mahatmas, they keep on telling us. Even after scaling the height, they try to maintain the same for the sake of us. Because we would not have understood them, we have not reached their level. But suppose they take everything, they freely mix with everything. With our limited mind, we are seeing only the outer, and we get confused. Because we measure others through our own limited finite intellect. So for the sake of that, they also maintain certain norms, though they are free from it. We should. Yatatokhyapi Kaunteya Purushasya Vivaschita. Even a person who has mastered the sense, turbulent sense of the word, Pramadhini Patavan. They carry away, aren't they? Before we know something, you know, we are carried away. Before we know, we are slipping. We would have already slipped. So you are the rider, but you are not free. Don't be so. Five organs of perception drag me out the moment they come in contact with the respective sense objects. All will have a meaning only when we try to bring in God. We are not disciplining for the sake of discipline. We are disciplining for the sake of moving towards Him. These are all taking me away, out. So that the distance between me and Him becomes vaster and vaster. And I have to reduce the distance. So all these things are, why am I becoming a man of steady wisdom? Then only I will be able to turn towards Him. If I am not aware of this, it will be an outer discipline like military discipline. No? Rashidji used to say, there were times when he was sitting in bhajan hall and if one child cries or disturbs, he will just pick him like this, you know, here, and then, Mataji saw this. Military, no? You are ex-military. To him, discipline is important. And Darshanji himself said, Mataji did not tell me directly because I may lose my temper and go away. Who will take care of me? Mataji is worried about that. So Mataji will ask Pooja Swamiji. I was told Darshanji did like that, ask him not to do it. And Swamiji has got his own way of doing it. This is an ashram. Discipline should be there. But the way of enforcing discipline is slightly different from what we do it outside. If you can't do it, you just tell somebody. You may not know the language. Like that, you know, slowly. The beauty is, the refinement has taken place in him, he himself conveyed to me all this. And he told me that was where he was searching. I was highly short-tempered. Suppose Mataji says something, oh, you and I, your ashram, I am going out. Then who will look after me? That is Mataji's work. A person of this character, wherever he goes, he will not be able to align himself with this. And who will take care of him? I'm joking at what you are telling me. So what we are trying to understand is discipline, not for discipline's sake. Na? I want to become a Siddhaprajna, not for the sake of Siddhaprajna, but for the sake of turning my mind towards inventing reality. Because otherwise, I will be always out. The question of being in does not come to me at all. And I have to realize this person within me. It should be very clear now. That's why yesterday is Paramdrishtva Nivartate. Because if the Paramdrishtva is not there, even that longing ceases when one realizes the Supreme. So realizing the Supreme should be there now. Realizing is present, feeling is present. These are all the things which prevent me from feeling its presence. So I am trying to become a Siddhaprajna so that my entire attention is turned towards him. So Indriyani Pramadhini Haranti Vashavam Manaha. The powerful sense organs drag away the mind of even a wise man. That is the nature of the sensory energy. Finally, if horses drive a carriage to wherever the horses want it to go, you become a helpless victim. You are the rider. But you are not free. Therefore, what we should do? Let us see the next sloka. Sani sarvani samyamya yukta asita vatpara vashuhi yatindriyani tasya prajna pravishta vati vashu vishdete vashi iti vashu. The steadfast, having controlled them all, sits focused on me as the Supreme. His or her wisdom is steady, whose senses are under control. Same thing. Therefore, tani indriyani samyamya. Discipline all the senses and sensory energies within you. Don't leave out even one. If there is one out, that is enough to destroy you. Little carelessness in our touching. All India mastered, but little carelessness. It is that it is enough to destroy you. So samyama means disciplining, controlling. That is why my devotees, every day, every year they go to Samyam Tattva. 7 days they observe. They subject themselves to various diseases. In Kankal, or Christopher, every year comes, they attend. Somebody doesn't take food at all, somebody takes little food, somebody takes one time of food, whatever it is. You don't feel. You are not constrained by anything. But you impose certain discipline suitable to your mental condition. And on, there will be so many such as these. Self-imposed discipline. But discipline will be there. It's a wonderful concept. When you are explaining about it, we knew that. Yeah. We are in the midst of so many things, so we go there. Of Previously, I don't know now. Previously in Guruvayur, people go for 41 days in Kadam. So at that time, you know, unknowingly you are subjecting yourself to various disciplines. You have no time to talk to anybody. You know? You have no time to go to shopping. You have no time for anything else. Because the whole day, you know, waking state, majority of excepting for your basic requirements, you go out for waiting or going to the toilet, something like that. The food was also then provided by the temple. Narayana Dhamma, yes. It's only Narayana, 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 Narayana Dhamma. People go there for 7 days, 14 days, 21 days. We start playing with the ritual, you know, it's not ritual. Samyama is being practiced in a different way. You have no time for anything. Immediately after food, again you sit. Nobody will say that you should do this, you should do that. You enlist yourself for Deva, Narayana Deva. You don't know whether somebody is there still. Look, look. Because people in Grihasthas may not be able to have all these things at their own home. So all Grihasthas, mostly mothers, and retired, gently have seen aged people, not working people. Very few. Otherwise, mothers. With full faith. And in between, they will go and have darshan of the Murti also. Prasad from there, and Narayana Japa will be going on. So, samyama. So, we have to discipline. We have to find out, no? Something only you have to keep on thinking, samyama. Discipline all the sensory energy within you. Don't leave out even one. Let's say we remember. Whatever the naivedya is there, that is offered as the chore and something they used to say. And of course, the old days there were some numbers, not like this. Bhagavan brings so many, so he is reaching out. Previously, there were, say, 100 people, 200, something like that. And he would say, and then say, yes, today's quota is over. And all of them were given food. Only that particular naivedya. And again, they are back again for Narayana. And the evening, they again go for bath, again come back and sit. Tight. So, because now we remember, why? Don't leave out even one. If there is one, it is enough to destroy you. Samyama means disciplining, controlling. They will remain. We don't destroy them, you know. We don't destroy the sense objects. We don't have any aversion towards them. We don't belittle them. We don't condemn them. But they will remain. We want a very strong sensory system. But they must be under our control. Just like in a journey, you want a powerful set of horses. Then only you can reach your destination. But they must be under your control. Otherwise it will be the horse's journey, not your journey. That should not be. So the verse says, Yukta Asita Makpara. Devoted to me. Remain in this life, controlling the psychic and sensory energy. Vashehi Yasindriyani. In whose control is the sensory system and the energy is residing there. Tasya Prajna Pratishthitaha. His or her wisdom is steady. What makes for unsteadiness of the mind and the buddhi, namely the sensory system, is already overcome. We have to discipline them. That is the beginning of all character training. That is the beginning of all. When children do something wrong, mothers will say, don't do that. Why do they tell these do's and don'ts in the beginning? Because a certain training is needed of the sensory impulses when we are young. Till we are able to control them, our parents will help us, or must help us. As we grow up, we take up the matter ourselves. We know what to do, what not to do, how far to go. That kind of training we try to give to ourselves. such a mind which has the power to discipline the enormously powerful sensory system, that mind is certainly going to be registered. We start from the sensory system. In fact, take any stone, there is no sensory system there. Only in a living being there is a sensory system. From the cell onwards up to man, there is a sensory system in simple and complex form. The sensory system up to the chimpanzee level is controlled by the external world or by the sensory objects. At the human level alone, we find a little capacity to say no to a sensory impulse. That no must be well developed, strong, steady. What is worthwhile, I shall pursue, not others. In all these traditional mutts, the senior monk, after some time he will be prompted to select who should be his successor. And what do? You know? They will be in the lookout. Nobody may know. But a particular family, when they come or they hear about and a boy is there, maybe 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, 8 years, immediately the guru identifies and requests the parents whether they are prepared to leave him in the mutt. And when they happily do that, he is taken right from the young age, so that he doesn't carry any baggage. Suppose we start thinking about it after 40 years, 50 years, baggage will be very heavy. Outwardly we may be doing it, but the problem we will be facing, you know. So there, the foundation is given, ethics. All these things are taught to him. So the mind gets, you know, get the learning, yeah. That is how the other day when we were reading Sukhas, you know, he was not exposed to the whole outer world at all. He was only the one, you know, Kudri Kannadu, just like, you know, the what is it called in English, we don't know. The I will not go this way or that way. The horses, you know, the makeup is such that it will only see a friend. No distraction. So we all say in Malayalam, Kudraki Kannadi, going. Not this way, that way. Straight. Focused. So he is focused. Shuka is focused only on this. He has no side attraction at all. So he was only seeing God as sugar. That is why he was able to say in an innocent way, sugar path, sugar statues, sugar house, everything sugar. And one sugar statue is talking to another sugar house. It is not in the lighter way. Because right from the title. In our case, what can we do? We can try, even now we can try. Pass it on to our younger generation. Otherwise the risk is there. Don't leave out even one. So that energy comes only from the spiritual dimension. That is the training that makes for high character spiritual development. And so this idea, Vashehi Asendriyani, in whose control are the senses, Tasya Prajna Pratishthitaha. His further wisdom is well established. This human body is a dead body. What makes it alive? The sensory energy. That energy makes the body a center of immense powers. And I have to handle them myself. Nobody else can handle them for me. If I don't handle them, they will handle me. And we become failures in life. That truth in Gita is going to say, in verses 64 and 67, two wonderful verses. So here in 61, he says, this is how we have to deal with the sensory system. If we don't know how to deal with it, there is every chance of our falling down and down and down and becoming completely lost. And it does not happen quickly, step by step. Slowly we slide. This sliding down is an interesting experience in human life. If you keep a car on a slightly inclined road, the car will start moving down gently if you have not applied the brake. Later on it accelerates and develops high speed, gets destroyed. Similarly, in the human system, there is this tendency to go downwards. The Gita is going to handle that subject in the next two verses. They are very famous verses. Chayato Vishayam. So before we go to that, only we can take it. Tomorrow is a very, very interesting.
Yeah.
Tomorrow, as usual, there is a break on Monday. So again, this sixth or seventh yoga, everybody must be having the Gita text. We hope and pray. Kindly open. You do not have opened for years or months or days. Kindly open. Go through the chapter 8 from 54 in chapter number 2. Yoga number 54, chapter number 2. And then we have come up to 61. Seven stanzas we have gone through. Kindly make it. Compare with your own life. Suddenly the meaning becomes very, very clear. First we are guided by the textual meaning. Something should be there to prompt us, you know. So the prompting comes because of reading these lines. And then, and to enable us to know the textual meaning, we can go through the literal meaning there, okay. But then you stop. Start jotting down the points from each that attracts you. Then try to connect it with your experience, what you have observed in others' life, in your own life. Where we were able to, by His grace, where we were able to stand firm, where we were carried away. And then, you know, the real purpose will be served. This exercise will definitely help. Otherwise, it will be a surface level activity, you know, or intellectual activity, okay? And we may derive some joy also, no doubt. But that is not what is expected of us by Lord Krishna. He did not stop. He took 18 shlokas to explain this, to hammer this into our mind. Somehow we know now the central message is we have to turn our attention towards Him. Whatever is happening only by His will. Whatever is happening is only for our happiness. We hold divinity in every aspect of this world. Verily, it is He who is behind all creatures and things. Easy to say that, no? We hold divinity in every aspect of this world. There is no field where this is not. We don't see it. We don't see it. We see it as an object, we see as a person, we see as a situation. Now through these six, we are reminded, I become a Sthita Prajna only when I try to see the God dimension. God ordained, God is testing me, God is making me impervious, God is making me Sthita Prajna, so that I can pull my entire energy, which otherwise would have got dissipated through the sense channels towards Him. Because I know now, the moment I am carried away by all these sense objects, through the sense organs, I am moving away from Him. Nobody will be able to remember. Probably because of that, at least on festive occasions, there is a system that before we take our meal, we used to chant, you know, some sloka from Bhagavad Gita or some Shanti Mantra. The palate control is the biggest thing. On all other things, we may not be able to do it. But at the time of eating, they will chant 15th chapter. In ashram, their orbit has become ritual. Nobody knows the meaning, purpose level. But at least one sloka, one shanti, in our case, Ram Nam, we were all having it. We all stopped it. Previously, you know, because it was at the surface level. Everybody goes there for breakfast, some of you might be remembering. Everybody sits there and Ram Nam, one mala starts. Or someone, you know, he will start. At the end of the month, by the time, we will be giving them plates or leaves, we will be serving. Even serving will be over. The last serving will be over by the 108th chant. Then everybody starts eating. The first Mataji introduced was that we will have Ram Nam before. But then, you know, we will be looking at it, you know. Shiram Dharam Dejaram. Chatni Vandu will go. It has lost its scope. He said it becomes surface level, so one day we told Swamiji, especially when we introduced buffet system. But we will play Ram Nam, and then those who are aligning themselves to the Ram, they will hear, no doubt. But purpose is, at the time of chanting and at the time of eating, because Gandhiji always warned, of all the senses, the most difficult one is the palate, aswad. That is why in the Ekadasha Vratam, the 11 vratas, you know, one has to observe while one is in Vardasham, aswad is there. So we will try to continue it on Monday. So kindly make a note of this, and if any anecdote or anything that you have, you can share it through email. So that we will share it to everybody in the rest. Hello. Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram. Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram. Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram 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 Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram